And I think we should move on to our last speaker today. She is Margot Boutsma. She is a PhD student at the Department of Human Movement Science, again, at the University Medical Center in Groningen. And so please, Margot, the floor is yours.
Yeah, thanks for the introduction. As we age, we experience a lot of unfavorable deteriorations in a variety of functions, such as the ability to perform simple motor tasks, such as putting your key in the keyhole. And next to this behavioral changes, we also experience some changes on the brain level. And on a structural level, we see the loss of both gray and white matter causing the brain to shrink. And what you see over here is the average annual loss of gray matter per year in healthy elderly normal subjects. And you can see that this average loss goes up to about 4 to 5% per year in even healthy older adults. And on a functional level, if we ask younger participants to execute a motor task with their right hand, so a unilateral motor task, we mostly see activity in the opposite contralateral hemisphere. However, if we ask older participants to execute the same motor task, we see that this contralateral activity increases, but we also see increasing activity in the opposite ipsilateral hemisphere. So there's an bilateral overactivity in older adults while performing the same tasks as younger adults. And based on all these changes, you might expect that the ability of older adults to learn new motor tasks also deteriorates. And this is what long has been taught. And but that's also been shown by a lot of studies, such as this study showing quite a dramatic drop in the learning rate between the ages of 50 and 60 years. However, there are also now more and more studies who show, such as the study from our own lab, who show that although the motor performance is different between younger and older adults, so they have worse motor performance, the actual rate of learning is the same. So they are able to learn this task as equally as younger adults. And there are even now studies who showed a superior learning rate in older compared to younger adults. So all in all, there's a lot of inconsistency in the literature about the ability of older adults to learn new motor tasks. And that is why with the current study, we aim to look further into these effects of age on skill acquisition and retention, and also dive a bit into the underlying brain mechanisms. And over here, you can see our study design. So we recruited 72 participants, among which 36 younger and 36 older adults. And they visited our lab for 2 days in a row. And on the first day, they practiced a mirror star tracing task, which you can see over here, in which we asked the participants to trace the outline of the star as fast and accurate as possible, while they were only allowed to look at the star in their moving hand through the mirror. And while performing this task, they were instructed that accurate performance is to stay within this width of the wall of the star, which we call the bandwidth. Before, immediately after, and 24 hours after they practiced this task, we measured their motor performance as well as their brain activity, which we did with 64 channel EEG. So you see here the whole setup for one of our older participants. So if we ask both the younger and older participants to do this, this is what a representative star looks like on the very first attempt. So the above, the blue one is the younger adult and the red one is the older adult. And well, you do see some performance differences already here. But then if we let both participants practice for a while, you see that for both the younger and the older adults, the star looks a lot better. And this is actually also what we see reflected in our outcome measures. So we quantify motor performance both in terms of movement time. So that is the time needed to execute one trial of the star, and it's a measure of speed. And we have a measure of accuracy, which is the bandwidth error, and which represents the percentage of trials in the percentage of samples in a trial, which participants were outside this width of the wall of the star. So for both outcome measures, lower scores means better performance. And what you can see here is that there was indeed a difference in motor performance between older and younger adults. So older adults had worse motor performance, but their rate of learning, so their slope of improvement from the pre to the post test, was actually quite similar for speed. And the rate of learning was even a bit higher in older compared to younger adults for accuracy. Interestingly, then if participants came back 24 hours after they learned this task, we saw that, well, for the younger adults, they maintained the improvement in speed. So they were still faster at 24 hour retention than that there were before learning, but they deteriorated on accuracy. So their accuracy level at 24 hour retention was actually back to their baseline level. And for older adults, we saw the opposite pattern. So they retained part of their improvements in accuracy, but they deteriorated in speed again at 24 hour retention. And prioritization of accuracy over speed in older adults is something that has been reported before in the previous literature, and it's mostly explained as a learned strategy of older adults in order to maintain the precision of this task, and in this case also in order to obtain enough feedback to actually be able to improve on this task. So all in all, what this behavior results show is that older adults are still able to learn new motor tasks, but that the approach to the task depends on age, so that older versus younger adults adopt a different approach. If we next look at our EEG data, what you see over here is a topographical plot of the task-related beta EEG power. And EEG power in the beta band is known to be dominant at rest and gets suppressed as people actually executing a motor task. So therefore, it is thought that lower EEG lower power during task execution is related to higher neural activity. And in this topographical plot, cooler colors represent lower task-related power. So the more blue, the higher the activity in a sense. And what you can see at baseline is that, well, for older adults, the activity pattern was pretty centralized and equally spread across the two hemispheres. We saw a slightly more lateralized activity pattern to the contralateral hemisphere for younger adults. And then as participants practiced the task, we saw a decrease in task-related power. And as you can see here, this was mostly apparent for older adults. And then when participants came back 24 hours later, we saw that we saw actually an increase to baseline levels again. And if we zoom a bit into this result more, and we look at the power in the motor cortex, because well, that's the area of the brain which is of course related to motor performance, but also to motor learning. What you see here is again the task-related power, and just a reminder, lower task-related power is indicated of higher neural activity. And this is in the motor cortex, and we see that the decrease in task-related power, which I just mentioned from the pre to the post test, was most apparent in the older adults and also mostly in the contralateral hemisphere. And it's possible that this increased modulation of EEG power in older adults represents a compensatory mechanism to enable these older adults to learn this task to an equal level as the younger adults, despite the changes that are happening in their brains. And this compensatory view Well, we actually find more evidence for this if we look at the correlation between differences in movement time from the post to the retention test and the differences in contralateral beta task-related power from post to retention. So what you see in this graph is this correlation separately for the younger adults left and the older adults right. And on the x-axis, you see the change in movement time from post to retention. And just for visual purposes, I refer to the axis such that right to the zero denotes an improvement in movement time from the post to the retention time point, and left to the zero is a deterioration. And on the y-axis, you see this, you see the contralateral beta task-related power, also the change in this power from post to retention, and the positive numbers denote an increase in task-related power, and the negative numbers is a decrease in task-related power. And what we see with this correlation is that we found a correlation which was specific for the older adults. And there was a relation between the deterioration in movement time and the increase in task-related power. So it means that less deterioration of movement time for post-retention was actually related to a smaller increase in task-related power from post-retention. So that means that the older adults who were able to maintain at least part of the changes in task-related power we saw directly after learning, those were also the older adults who are able to maintain part of the improvements in movement time we saw directly after learning. So this suggests that this decrease in task-related power we see after learning in older adults is indeed compensatory to be able to learn this task. So to wrap it up, with this task we saw that older adults are still able to learn new motor skills, actually to a comparable level as older adults. But we see that during learning, older adults seem to prioritize accuracy in this task, while younger adults seem to prioritize the speed. And we also saw that age affect the neural mechanisms of visual motor learning. And specifically, we see a higher decrease of power for older adults, which is possibly a compensatory mechanism to still improve in this motor task. So with this, I want to thank all my collaborators and co-authors, as well as the students who helped me collect all this data. And as a take-home message, I showed with these results that although we do experience a lot of deterioration as we age, not all is lost. And I hope with the right motor skills and interventions, we can change the picture of aging from this video I showed in the beginning to the video of this old man still dancing and moving happily. So thanks for your attention, and I'm happy to answer all the questions, and also my email is here if you want to discuss anything further.
Thank you very much, Margot. Super nice talk, and very interesting how you did this study collecting both the behavioral and performance outcomes and the EEG data, and trying to find a correlation between the two. So while I encourage the attendees to ask questions, I have one myself. At the beginning, you showed that there are those conflicting results about contralateral or ipsilateral activation in young and older adults. Is that something that has been found on EEG studies, like the one that you did, or also in some fMRI studies or neuroimaging studies?
This bilateral overactivation with aging is actually quite robust finding found with a lot of different techniques. So it's also been found a lot with fMRI studies next to the EEG studies.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Well, for now, we don't...